if we want to speak?
Yeah, you can put your hands up. I'm not going to respond to it.
Can I barge in over the top of you?
Absolutely. No.
It's not a good idea. Last time.
Hey guys, what's up? Burnsy didn't want me to do an intro this week, so we're not going to do one, I guess.
Fuck you, that's not what I said.
We're snacking on some lollies. We're having some fun because it's pre-YCS now. I hope you guys enjoyed.
Post-YCS, Ronan.
Post.
We have had the YCS.
Did I miss
again.
It?
Start again.
Did I sleep through it again?
Start again.
Fuck.
You're now listening to Mushroom Man FM, where we play nothing but Invoked, Dogmatica, and Shadows. This ain't your Yugi Boomer station.
She can too say that again.
That's not while you're recording. Nice try.
She can crack what? Sorry. Whoa, that's crazy, bro. Hey guys, welcome back. It's post YCS, Sydney. We're all out here, eating lollies, just kind of chilling. This one's gonna be more of a vibe session and a story. If you guys saw the last episode, I believe we had all kind of settled on what we were playing. So I guess we'll just go into the story now, from beginning to end, and try and just paint you a picture of what happened. So there is, the Brenner boys, us three, our friend Kieran.
Hello.
And, one of our teammates, Anna.
Hello.
Yeah, that was her cue to talk, but she was like, no.
Nope.
She may have missed her cue slightly.
We also had two other teammates, another woman, Cynthia, and then we had a surprise guest. It was like in Smash Bros. When you unlock a new character. We had our friend Aethryn show up. It was great. Let's go back to Thursday. So on Thursday, we all finished work, and the Brandon boys and Kieran, we decided we...
What do you mean, and Kieran?
And Kieran, you know.
You don't ever wear the merch.
You never wear our merch.
I'm the tag along. I see how it is.
You're a tag dog.
You play synchro.
We got on the... So, we all get on the plane together to go to Sydney because the other boys are already there, right? And by the other boys, I mean, we have no idea that Aethryn's coming and the two women are already there in Sydney because they live there. We get on Jetstar. Already a bad time. We go on Friday, so we, the Brenner boys sleep over, we wake up, Burnsy, I believe you slept on the couch.
I did sleep on the couch. It was a great time.
Yeah.
I passed out right on that thing. We had been deck building and stressing all night. You and I had a good back and forth about branded ratios where I just... After the discourse of last episode where I was praising your deck building, I then behind closed doors beat the crap out of you for your deck building.
Stupid motherfucker.
Yeah.
So,
shout out to Mushroom Man, by the way, with me sleeping right next to all of his tins of bulk, and he just walks, like, shuffles in with his thongs, loudly slapping his way past me, like, need this, and then
we have a bed laid out for him, but he's like, no, I'm gonna sleep right here. And so it's our flight's at 6:30 or 7 in the morning, but we have to leave by 6:30. We have to get to Kieran's house by 6:30 to get him and then drive there.
That was a shit show. It was
so I wake up at 5:30 and I go, oh, I haven't packed my bag. I spent up till 2:30 last night sleeving my three decks, one of which I didn't play pretty much at all. I only had settled on the list the day of, and I mean the day of, as midnight went 2 hours past, I was like, all right, this is the list. So it consists of, a gimmick puppet, because I did find one in time. No soul release because I couldn't find one in time, even though Kieran had one, and I was just like, oh, fucking, we just won't play, don't worry about it.
How many packs was it, Metal Raiders?
How
many packs of Metal Raiders did you open in the lead up?
You cracked Metal Raiders.
I cracked half a box of Metal Raiders to get a common soul release.
I literally, somewhere at home, have a whole box of Metal Raiders that I know was chockers full of soul release.
I have a YCS vlog coming soon, and in that, it's me cracking open half a box, I get... a Change of Heart, which is an ultra. I get everything else. The only two commons I don't get a Mushroom Man 2 and Soul Release.
Oh. At that point, you know Konami's got an agenda.
I get an Ultra 2. Like, I'm just like, I guess I'm just fucking, I'm not going to play Soul Release then.
Did you play Change of Heart?
Yes.
Good. Of course. So the box wasn't a waste.
Yeah, no, the box was...
Except you played the secret from Rarity Collection.
Yeah. No, I played the actual one because I couldn't find the secret because my bulk's everywhere. We are recording this in a kingdom of bulk, by the way.
I actually can't see Ronan over the bulk.
Yeah, I can't see. I've got cataracts and bulk.
Caused by bulk.
Went to the optometrist and they were like, there's so many snake eye oaks in
here. Is that a structure deck in your cornea?
Jesus.
So, I finally settle on a list. They get up at a reasonable time. I get up too late. I pack my bag. We have 50 minutes late. The problem with this, right, is that Kieran wanted us to wait around slightly longer than what the airport recommended us for a time to check in. So we would have been 30 minutes later than what they recommended. And I went, you know what? It's fine. We'll just, instead of getting dropped off, which would be cheaper, and waiting for Kieran's stepmom. Kieran is 17, by the way, in a Adam Sandler movie.
Yeah, years from death.
Yeah.
It's true.
Just because he's 58. Jesus Christ.
I have cancer. They don't know this yet.
They don't know this
yet. I have 17 years left to live.
I have terminal pancreatic cancer, stage 5.
They have removed my pancreas. It grew back.
And it's full of cancer.
It's full of cancer.
We go, fuck it, we'll pay for parking. So, after arguing with Kieran, we get there in Bernie's car.
Yes.
We ask Kieran to get in. And while we're driving, we're like, fuck, we gotta play some tunes, man. We gotta play Life as a Highway. Because you know we gotta play Life as a Highway. It was great.
The vibes were very strong. Because we were playing your playlist, and I think it went straight from Life as a Highway to The Soul of Cinder from Dark Souls 3. Yeah. Absolute vibes in that car.
I don't know why that's my in my riding playlist. I must have misclicked or something. But it went from bam, bam, bam to oh.
So I was ready to fight.
it's Brock being consumed by his luggage that he took. He took 3 bags. I took like a very small like.
Brock took a suitcase larger than him.
Yeah, Brock took a suitcase that was larger than him. I took like a knapsack. And that was it.
Which got infinitely more complicated logistically when we do get off the plane. And there's even more stuff in Anna's car, who was lovely enough to pick us up. But it was like, you need to become one with the suitcases if you wish to ride.
So Brock, any time that we have changed places, remember that Brock, who's not with us because he's currently dead, is getting smothered by his own luggage because he's like, oh, I'll take a suitcase, it'll be fine. It can't go wrong.
Oh yes.
So we're on the highway. Kieran's Kieran's like, oh fuck, I forgot my fucking AirPods.
That's right.
Brock's dying. Benji's like, fuck, I need to get up the address. Ronnie, can you get up the address? And I'm eating a banana and being like, fuck, this is so nice.
I was panicking. You don't understand. You may have been awake at 5:30 and everything. There are probably permanent marks in your floorboards from how much I was pacing. I was sitting there like, please.
My bad.
I can't do this.
My bad.
Just get in the car.
Please. Just play Solace, and he's like, fuck, I'm not having a boss battle right now. I'm on the M1, but 15 minutes late.
Also, shout out to the good gentleman standing in the middle of the roundabout.
So he gets there.
Selling overflow parking.
We are convinced he's homeless.
He was definitely not airport. He does not
airport
represent stuff. The airport's interests. No. No way.
He was pocket. He was like, cash only, mate.
Cash only.
We get there. Exact change
only. Apparently, there's no parking, so we roll up to this random guy, and he's like, cash only. No. He's like, you have to park in the university. And we're just like, fine, we scramble for it. And we're like, what if that guy just is bullshitting us, you know? We didn't check.
No, he gave me a printout with a JPEG of the airport logo. It's reasonable.
Not even a PNG on like a widescreen, just JPEG.
Joke's on him, I got a free day because I misspoke.
Ooh.
I was like, oh yeah, 3 days. So he charged me and then we drove past and I was like, we're going to be there for 4 days.
And then Benji's car got towed.
I mean, hey, look, if we're getting technical, this is a bit of a tangent. The following week, I flew back to Sydney to actually come up with Anna, who is now a Queensland resident.
Woo!
There was still no parking.
Wow.
And good old homeless man was not there. So guess you still had the slip of paper.
these two go flying all the time. It's a nuisance.
If Queensland, if Coolangatta Airport is watching this,
have seen two people more often.
If Coolangatta Airport has seen this, get back to your fucking job. We almost crashed twice.
Get back on the fucking roundabout.
You are a pillar of this community.
Without you, we are nothing.
We can't fly. We get there. We pay for parking, we get our shit, we get out. We manage to get there in time, right? So we're going in there and we're like, alright, Anna's gonna pick us up, it's all good. Let's just go through. I get stopped by security, they thought I had a bomb me. It's fine, you know, don't worry. We'll
just watch the last three episodes.
Yeah.
In which you threatened to bomb Sydney.
Yeah.
Specifically.
Yeah, they did say, hey, you mushroom man, and I panicked. I also had to go back to the line because I asked her, I was like, hey, can I bring this drink or do you want me to bin around? She's like, you have to bin it outside. And I was like, all right. and they were like, all right, we're going to test you for a bomb. I was like, very cool. So it was off to a good start. It wasn't helped by the fact that as we got on the plane, they selected the four of us morons.
They did, you're right.
They selected the four of us to be, what do you call it?
Emergency
landing help?
Yeah.
Something.
And I called us the safety squad.
We looked at us and went, we're fucked. You guys are all fucked, we are fucked.
Was it Kieran who said, you're not getting off this plane without a door?
If we're going down, pull out a speed door deck, bitch. It's on.
You've got 4,000 life points. Let's see what you can do.
I got Beaver Warrior, and you've got about 30 seconds until this plane hits. As everyone gets on, a film crew comes on, which is one person and a person holding the camera.
I'll be honest, they were here. I thought that they were here to document our journey.
Yeah, I was like, oh, they think I'm Jesse Cotton. That's fucked.
Renan really sprung for the vlog.
I paid some good fucking money. I should have paid more money because as that person announced, it was International Women's Day. I'll be honest, didn't realize that was a thing. But.
Wow.
Whoops.
Wow.
It's fine though because as they were filming it, you know, they do this little promo. It's like, only women are on this plane, only women are working in, and Kieran the Mizzy turns to me and goes, we're fucked. And I was like, fuck, he stole my joke. So next to the emergency seats, the four seats that are in the middle of the plane that we have to sit in now because we got moved. Waitresses or flight
attendants? Stewardess.
Stewardess, thank you. They have their seats there. So one of them comes up and sits right next to me. And me being autistic strikes up a conversation with them.
Never in my life have I panicked so much than when you started talking to the stewardess.
What have I ever done?
We went the whole flight until we were landing into Sydney, and then you sparked up a conversation with her. I thought, that's it, we're done. We're finished.
They're going to turn around.
What you have to understand is that at any given moment, Mushroom Man has like 6 or 7 cancelable quotes in his back pocket that he can't hold on to.
There's
They're
already
go.
5 or 6 being dropped in this one podcast.
God, I fucking hate Sydney.
Specific billboard in Sydney that says, do not make jokes.
Do not make jokes, Ronan.
Specifically Ronan.
You were about to say, you said, Ronan's about to say a couple of slurs, and I immediately went to something that I might just have to blur out. I was immediately going to be like, Palestine deserved it. And then I was like, oh, we got it.
There's a legitimate billboard in Sydney that says, in an airport, jokes about bombs are not funny. Crack one, and you could miss your next flight. So.
I didn't miss my next flight.
You did crack a bomb joke.
Yeah, I went, I'm going to bomb Sydney, and as we were getting on the plane.
Oh my god!
I need you to know.
Within earshot of the stewardess.
You told me, sitting in on this podcast, being a Brandon boy, every episode it would get easier to cope with your shenanigans. It has not.
Absolutely not.
I feel complicit somehow.
I'm going to have to bleep out that one. So, yeah, as we As we are landing, I strike up a conversation with the stewardess because I mean, like, fuck it, what's there to lose? And I didn't strike up a conversation at the beginning because, one, that's kind of rude. They're doing their job. And two, I've never seen a person look more wanting to die than I've seen myself in the mirror. This person was not happy, and I was like, ooh, fuck.
She looked real robotic, eh? Do you remember her name?
ZX2
Mark
7. Yeah. I was gonna say Ebony, but that's probably better. Oh, wasn't it? Fuck! Oh! Shout out to that one bitch who was gonna kill me. This person, shout out to the one stewardess that I thought, if I talk to you, you're gonna kill me. She did not look happy, but I was like, fuck it. I'm gonna strike up a conversation anyway.
To her credit, she was incredibly kind.
She was actually. Her name was Bridget.
Oh, shout out Bridget.
Is this just a gambit the whole time? You remembered, but you were like, go on, asshole. Yeah, tell him the name.
Yeah. Go on.
Honestly, Bridget was... Oh, yeah, that's right, because I was like, okay, like the Guilty Gear character. And then I went, that's stupid. Why do you know the name from Guilty Gear? The Bridget is just a name.
So many other Bridgets in media. You picked the one from Guilty Gear.
Could have said Total Drama Island, I would have been fine. She was like, I shook up a conversation, and I was like, so how long have you been doing this, blah, blah, blah. And then she goes, yeah. By the way, we know it's International Women's Day and we filmed that thing, but there wasn't enough women working in the on this plane side. The ground crew are all men. And I was like, that's funny.
And thus the truth comes out.
I mean, I wasn't going to say anything. Like, we're sitting, like, you're sitting, like, next to the window seat.
Yeah.
And I'm in, the passenger aisle, like, the middle aisle. As they're filming that, I'm looking out the side, looking at the blokes, loading up the bottom of the plane. I'm like, women.
Good for them, I think. So, I didn't realize this until we started taking off. Kieran doesn't like flying.
There's some stories we can tell. So just to interject slightly, for YCS Sydney 2023, it was just me and Kieran. We were vibing. This man was shaking, this man was swearing, this man was hurling abuse at Jetstar staff. He was not okay.
Really?
I mean, flying's not cool, bro. it's not a vibe.
The entire trip, I was asking about Kieran's newer job, which was a horticulturist.
Yeah, that's the one.
Which is a plant looker and bird fucker.
No, we don't fuck birds.
Oh, well, I was so interested.
Not more this week.
You're thinking of Tasmanians, please continue.
I thought you going to say the Tasmanian
that's
devil.
That's their cousins, not birds.
Oh. Whoa.
Same thing.
Yes.
I mean, well, eventually.
Where do you think the phrase, look at that hot bird, comes
hot
from?
Bird.
Look at that hot bird.
It came from Tasmania. From guys looking at Kikinajashifuko, the unaffected bird.
The unaffected bird. It's like an epithet.
Kieran doesn't know. It's like a racial slur. Kieran does not like flying. So as we are taking off, I'm talking to him about it. He's like, humans were meant for flying, man. If we had wings, we'd be able to fly. And as we're taking off, it's a little rough. And I'm like, die, die, death, die, death.
Safety squad, by the way.
I can see. I can see.
Aisle 11. Exit over the wings. Die, 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 death, die, death, die, die.
I can see Brock cackling and an Asian lady go, she turns to me and she goes,
your lives are in our hands.
You're fucked. We go in for a really rough landing. So we're getting there. We hit the ground real hard. And before I can say a single joke, immediately the stewardess goes, bet that was the other pilot, not the main one. And I go, fuck, even you're on air too. She goes, I can tell that wasn't the good pilot.
Which, by the way, did not make me feel any fucking better about it.
We were in spitting distance of each other, all three of us. And Kieran goes, I fucking hate flight. And she goes, that wasn't the good pilot, and thinks that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Perfect. I'm calm now.
Kieran, don't worry. We got the substitute to land. It's fine.
And then Bridget, the lovely woman that she is, goes right back to looking like she wants to kill anyone. And I go, all right, that was a nice conversation. We'll see you next time.
You know, our interaction with people like this lovely Bridget lady convince me that all of you are NPCs.
Go on.
Well, no, like, I just... All the time, I see people walk past me and they just got this, like, blank look on their face. And I just think, like, I could press A and you'd say, really nice weather out.
Hello, sir.
And
then there are raiders walking north of Selstime. I need your help.
Can I blow your mind?
Yeah.
That's why I talk to people. Because I go, I wonder what dialogue I can get out of these people.
Wow.
So if
they might have a quest, bro.
If I go up to you and I strike up a conversation, it's not because I'm genuinely interested or I want to make small talk. It's because I'm fucking with you.
I actually... So I was thinking about this yesterday because I saw this one park guest at work who just like was like just looked like an NPC. Like there was just nothing going on in the head.
Polygons and everything.
It could have been. And I thought to myself, like, imagine if I just followed you home. And then like you just and then you just like hung yourself up in the closet and just waited till tomorrow's, you know, reset time.
Kieran at 4 AM waiting for the frame refresh.
Yeah. Like,
come on man, I gotta
I am so not convinced that you are not NPCs.
I gotta steal your potions. Come on, man. So we get there, we land, we text Anna, we meet up with other people that we know that are also going. Everything's good. We get our luggage, everything's fine. We go to Anna's car. Anna's car is full of shit. Her shit specifically. So a PS5, which I try to take the entire trip, just kind of sneakily put into my luggage, but I didn't bring a suitcase and Brock won't let me borrow his. So while Brock is getting smothered in the back, we're driving. Do we make any pit stops before we get there?
I don't think we did.
I think it's straight to the hotels.
Yeah. Well, you say straight. We did get lost several times.
Left, right, yeah. left, right. Fuck, I hate Sydney.
I'm going to bomb Sydney. I'm going to bomb Sydney.
Yeah, the immortal quote of you, Kieran, every single time we travel, leaning in very close and saying, God does not live here.
Fucking doesn't.
How many times have you guys traveled together? Is that twice?
That was the second time. But the first time we didn't have you and Brock as the cream between the Oreos. It was just he and I.
This YCS, by the way, was one of my favorite memories of all time. I'm going to be completely honest. It was...
Yeah, we should talk about it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we're fucking doing.
We should start a podcast and talk about it.
Wait, we could call it Branded Boys.
No, that's fucking retarded.
Right, that's a shit name.
You know, you can only do it if you put a Z at the end.
Yeah. Fuck you. Fuck you.
Boys.
We're just Blonde Boys doing what Branded Boys do.
I want the new like art for the channel to be the card D Boys, but you just badly edit our faces.
I'm gonna dox you guys.
D Boys.
You know what? It's gonna all three of them are gonna be Anna.
Yeah, do it.
No. So there's we get to the hotel. We're split between the three hotels that are near Edward Flack Avenue. It's the Accor Stadium at Sydney Olympic Park. Budget Ibis. These two last minute decide, oh, you know what? You know what would be funny? If we get married at Sydney and we'll just have a hotel. So they got married and had an Elvis style wedding. It was really nice. They shack up there. Me, Brock, and Kieran shack up at the Budget Ibis because we're fucking poor players.
In a literal shoebox.
In a shoebox.
If you've ever been to YCS Sydney, the Budget Ibis is a proving ground.
Oh, 5-star rating.
Meanwhile,
that foyer after dark is something else.
So the regular Ibis is nice. It's just a hotel, right? We get some drinks at the end of Friday. It's fine. The Budget Ibis, however, the foyer of that is a sweat pit for duelists.
You walk in and the smell hits you like a truck.
It does.
This year and last year, it was bad.
I reckon it was worse. I didn't smell it last year. This year, after coming back from the steakhouse, but like Anna said, hits you like a bus.
It hits you like a steak dog.
It's like... If I was to describe it, it's like when you are exploring in the wilderness and you find a cave and you shine your torch inside it and there's like 80 bats that suddenly look at you with glowing eyes. That's how the Yu-Gi-Oh players look at you when you emerge. You're like,
hello? Except it's prey. It smells like all those
binder
bats
for trade?
You got trains? I've got bat, vanilla bat.
Kobe, man. Kobe was hard on the grind with the trade.
We'll get there, trust.
Jesus.
So,
I fully agree with the Konami policy for the sniff test.
Yeah. That's what I forgot.
This.
Did you not pull that on people several times?
I was really tempted to be like, judge who smells bad.
As we were getting onto the plane, Kieran goes, What if they sniff test us right before takeoff and I go, then we're fucked. We're not going to get to Sydney one way or the other.
We smell better than most Queenslanders, let's be honest.
Sniff test? Ooh, ooh. Stinky. Get off.
Game loss.
Pilot, confiscate his deck and burn it in front of him.
We're going to bomb this planet and you're going to be the cause of it. <Uh-oh>. Confiscate.
Stinky.
Anyway.
By the way, Cynthia decides to get the very luxurious hotel that we use as our professional dueling practice because we're not plebs like the other people at the foyer, aka the judges, the people at Cowboy for Game, and literally every other duelist. Yeah, that's the one of the Yu-Gi-Oh podcast, Cowboy for Game. I met them, they were nice. Shout out. They use the Krispy Kreme stand, and I pointed out to Brock that I wanted to do that too. But unlike them, we were so far in the tournament that we had no time to do it. No offense to the Cowboy for Game people, but as I was watching the video, I was like, I remember you. You weren't at the top tables.
Is that the mark of success? Because if that's the case, this channel's going to die.
I was about to say, Ronan, where were you by round five?
Where were you by round five?
I was in the legends room. I was in the legends room.
The retard room. The special room with Ojama Yellow.
Oh my god. She was sat next to me in round five.
So, we all practice a little bit and we decide. What do we do for dinner on Friday?
We went to the steakhouse in a row.
Yeah.
Because no, we're classy individuals.
Wasn't that Saturday and Sunday?
No,
not Friday?
No, Sunday. I don't even know.
It was Sunday.
We ditched.
So they we go to the steakhouse. We're like, okay, we're gonna have dinner, and then we're gonna do a tournament, and then we'll do karaoke because we probably won't win. They go to think, my diabetic pump because I'm diabetic decides to fucking explode, and I go, I'm a smart man. I probably brought a change. Look at my bag, no change, and I go, I've got about 2 hours till I die. So the entire night was ruined by me running around and trying to find some way to not die. These people had a great dinner.
A great dinner.
It was a good dinner.
We tried our best. It's not quite the same without you.
It's fine, I got the run back. But I finally managed to not kill myself. Six of us. Aether and Syl isn't in the picture yet. Oh no, we get that full registration to go and sign up. I find Aether in the corner stairwell. Aether is our seventh member. We didn't think was coming. He shows up, me and Brock go, what the fuck, what are you doing here? And he goes in his really, he's got such a sultry Chinese accent.
He's one of my favorite people in this world. Like, he was... Oh, look, he doesn't, like, he speaks English, but he's still got a very heavy, like, accent. And just the way that he combines, like, casual language with, like, his very formal way of speaking, but he's just so excited. Every time he sees me, he's like, oh, Matty, hello! I'm like, you are my favorite person! Oh, Aether, I'm so glad you're here.
Me and Cynthia and Brock are lining up to see what the... So, the organization for this event was fucking dog shit.
Australian Yu-Gi-Oh, generally, yes.
So there's only one line for anything. If you were probably like me, you signed up on your own at the very last hour, but there was still just one line for every side event. So me and Cynthia and Brock go to line up for what we think is a winner match for Friday and to get our coins. You don't get your coins until tomorrow, which is when the main event is on, so you're going to have to find some time to do that. So hope you're not winning and not going to time for 9 rounds in a row. Aether comes in and I go, Aether, what are you doing here? And he goes, oh, hello Ronan, very good, how are you? And I go, we're so fucking in, boys. This is so good.
The gang's all here.
The gang's all here. So now the full roster is complete. It is me, unbranded. Burnsy, unbranded.
Yeah.
Anna, unbranded.
Yeah.
We're playing very close list. There's only like one card difference between them. Mm-hmm. Anna's playing D Shifter, and me and Burnsy swept between Ad Libitum and Dramaturge.
That's true. It was very close. I think that's a very interesting debate to have. I would love to shine a lovely light on Anna, who I believe was playing Warcrime.deck.
Yes. Yeah.
Would you like to share your philosophy with the
class? My philosophy for this YCS was, it is a game of stamina. The first day, Saturday, was 9 rounds, because I think they were insane, which go for 45 minutes.
That wasn't even all of Swiss, it was 10 rounds Swiss.
10 rounds
and they played
Swiss,
90%
and they played
of it.
9 of them in one day. My philosophy was to play the least amount of Yu-Gi-Oh! Possible.
Hmm.
So I committed warcrimes.ex.
Would you like to tell us about some of your funny picks?
3 D-Shifter in the main. Gimmick Puppet Nightmare in the main.
Don't worry about it.
Cross out Designator in the main.
For the Gimmick Puppet.
For the Mira. Gimmick Puppet and Dragoon.
Dragoon!
Dragoon
in the
Turbo.
Main. So it was Shifter in draw phase, followed by making Dragoon.
Holy
and watching
shit.
Snake Eyes try to play it. Jokes on me, I did not play against Snake Eyes the entire YCS.
It's true, somehow she ducked it.
Despite having an 82% representation.
She is the 18%.
Wow, that was a lot.
My first 4 rounds were all fucking Snake Eyes.
Yes, they were.
It was crazy. Yeah, so 3 of us were on branded. Kieran, you're on branded synchro.
Yeah, I varied it up a bit, and you know, people were like, oh, I'm going to de-barrier this kid. And I went, no, you're not.
I don't care, synchro. And they're like, what?
And they went, what?
You can make, what the fuck is a Chaos
Wait,
Angel?
What do you mean you made Chaos Angel with a light and a dark?
What
I just locked you out of fusion.
I'm playing poorly. I can't out that.
Kieran, I choose to believe that you just got hit with the nastiest de-barrier once 3 years ago, and you decided never again.
Went, you know what? There's got to be a better way to play this deck.
Sure, that's why I was on Crossout. Brock is on Labyrinth, which will come up later.
The less we say about that, the better.
Which will come up later. There's a reason he's not doing this podcast. I can hear him. He's shuffling down the corridor as we speak.
Just like headbutting the wall. Stupid lovely, stupid lady, stupid welcome.
The 2 people that almost cleared Swiss were not anyone in this room. It was actually the 2 that aren't here. Cynthia, who was on Snake Eye Pure, and Aethryn, who was on Hero, Elemental Hero. He went undefeated for the first 6 rounds.
I spread folklore about this man because we play often at locals, and you know, I am by no means the best player at our locals, but because I play a lot of branded, I get a lot of people hyping up that they're scared to face me. Sure, whatever. Aethryn terrifies me.
Fuck, he's terrifying.
This man, every time we have played, has with a scalpel systematically taken me apart. I do not think I could beat him if my life depended on it.
Those 2 people are definitely competitive material. Mostly because Cynthia, I know you're not listening, but I'm gonna roast you anyway. Cynthia takes great pride in being able to spend a lot of time and dig down to what she really likes to do with Yu-Gi-Oh, which is competitive, which is fine. Aethryn is just built different.
He just shows up and dominates.
He's in another
Holy
dimension.
Fuck. The only reason he lost was because, you know, it's a YCS. In deck building, you have to play perfect and realize that out of the 10 rounds of Swiss, you're going to lose 2 of them. 1, because you lost the die roll and high roll sacked. 2, because you bricked. Those are the 2 games you're allowed to lose. Aethryn, unfortunately, bricked 1 game against Snake Eye and lost the die roll. And then at the end, to seal the deal, he played against Tribrigade Sprite in round 9, and I remember I was watching him because I had already finished my match, and I was like, fuck, I was gonna verse him with Tribrigade, but I was like, no one's gonna play Tribrigade in this event. He's going off what he knows based on what he's tested with us. I don't think I've ever played against him with Tribrigade, and I'm sitting there and he's reading the cards. He picks up Kit, he picks up Tribrigade Revo, and he goes, fuck. I see him just go, oh. I'm like, oh no.
That is always incredibly rough when you're in a top level event and you're like, yep, I'm flying blind. This is good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was Aethryn's run. He almost made it. Cynthia almost made it. She was the only one who had it was X2 in after day 1. So 1 more round for day 2, which is dumb, but I'll get to it. As we are all going into the event as like a posse, it's like a wrestling match, and you know, Cynthia's got the gloves on, she's like, yeah, I'm gonna fuck this guy up. And we're like her like posse, who's like her security detail. Matchlip comes down. I go, that's Cynthia. And that's YouTuber Yassine. And Cynthia posts to the Discord, fuck. And so guess who shows up? Yassine does, and he goes, "Hello guys, what's up? Today I'm gonna be mutilating your friend's corpse with this Snake Eyes deck."
Oh man, like I love Yassine. It was so cool to see him there. I got a photo with him.
So did I.
Look, he's... It's really rough, but also really cool, because, like, a part of me was like, I would love to have played against Yassine, but I also know full well if I lose to him, it's like... Have any of you guys in this room seen Mean Girls? The movie, yep. Mean Girls? The moment when the guy's like, that one time she punched me in the face, it was awesome.
That's great.
Literally Yassine, for real.
It was crazy. Last year was only three pro players, and one of them was Jesse Cotton.
He won. Did he really?
This year was a couple of them. We got Yassine, which was good. There was pro players, but...
Was Mr. LeBlanc there?
Yeah, he was.
Mr. LeBlanc was there.
Yes, we will get to him. Let's go back in time. So the organization was so bad that as we were lining up, we thought we were lining up for Winamat. It turns out we were lining up for everything. So we got there and we got to choose one thing to do. So imagine this, right? Winamats are not there. So you're not doing anything Friday. So first of all, what the fuck are we lining up for? It was the giant cards, which by the time that me and Cynthia had arrived, and by the way, we were pretty much at the front of the line. Giant card one was all sold out. Edison and giant card two were halfway full already. And by the way, these started day two and we were lining up for them day zero. So you wouldn't know if you were going to be playing Edison, even though you had signed up, because you weren't sure if you were going to clear the main event.
There's also the fact, I don't want to talk too much trash on the organization, even though it's not great. Didn't the giant Zeus card get creased?
Yeah.
It got bent.
I saw it. As the Zeus card was getting moved up because someone had won it, the judge took it and bent it. And everyone was like, ooh. And I was like, why the fuck is it on Clear App?
It's visceral pain.
People, like, it's so unorganized. Like, the judges aren't getting paid. Every judge, by the way, as we were sitting in the budget IBIS detoxing from Sunday, so it's about 6 o'clock Sunday, day 2, 6 judges come in, and they have a trash bin full of mats, and they go, who wants it? And, like, by 6 of them, I mean one by one with 20-minute intervals. That's how they get paid, by the way. They just came into the budget IBIS and was like, what do you want for this? 150, cool, go on. And, by the way, that's against Konami policy, but everyone didn't care. The judges didn't care. I didn't care. No one else cared.
The energy of 6 judges entering that Thunderdome that was the stink ball.
The stink ball.
The stink pit.
I wasn't there personally when that happened. I am picturing like a Mad Max like scene of posse of people with like shotguns. Like, all right, line up, deck lists in your hand.
Whoever's playing Runic doesn't get one. By the way, not just any judges, the top judges were there. And I can't say who it was, but like the top judges were there. So, you know, thanks Konami. But you know, what are you gonna do? So we all sign up. I get to sign up for the Edison and go, well, I hope I just don't make day 2 of the YCS. Shouldn't be that easy, right? Everyone else kind of fucks off, I think. I think we all just kind of hang out and we go vendoring, and there are 2 vendors in this entire thing. And from last YCS, they sectioned off one of the ends, so there was even less room this time. And there was less food places as well. One of them wasn't open.
One of them shut at 2 p.m.
Wow. And
you could not... Well, you could leave if you wanted to drop out of the rounds.
I was doing quite well in the event. I don't know if we've hit the point where we're going to go around and compare stories and everything, but like... I was dead on my feet going into round 8.
7.
7?
Yeah.
Sure, 7. Yes, Anna was kind enough to run across the road because she had dropped out because she had inflicted enough mental damage.
Yeah, I did. She
that was the goal, yeah.
Yeah, she brought me a Subway. I've never eaten a sandwich faster in my life. Oh
this,
my god.
This is why women shouldn't be allowed to play Yu-Gi-Oh! Is because they get their partner's food.
Take a shovel, dig your way out.
I'm digging the hole deeper. That's bullshit, that's cheating. You get food, I have to sit there as a dirty, stinky nerd without a girlfriend. Unfucking believable.
Okay.
This is bullshit. Judge, my opponent's hot.
To note that the actual vendors, the food vendors in a cursed stadium, charge so much for food.
Mm.
Kieran,
yeah,
I
was like baffled by how much it cost, to the point where I told the guy to rescan it and double check it. And when he gave me the same price, I picked it up and went, that's fucking bullshit. Tapped my card.
So anyway, 3 minutes later, you were munching on chicken.
I was. You put
was
the
it
money
like $12
down.
For a hot dog or something?
No, it was like $18 for a hot dog.
It was $18 for 8 pieces of like chicken nugget and a drink.
Konami, we at Australia, we're a continent. You don't organize your one YCS a year. It's in Sydney, the second worst city.
Wait,
it's in Melbourne.
After Detroit. Wait.
Yeah.
What's
in Australia?
If Sydney's the second worst.
Melbourne.
I don't know.
Nobody went.
Yeah, do you want to go to Melbourne for a YCS? Do you want to go to Perth for a YCS?
It could be cold down there.
I'd rather go to Darwin. Oh, you know what? That's the only thing I'll give it.
I'd rather do Alice Springs.
Cooper Petey YCS?
Mount Isa.
Melbourne did better with the older YCSs. So, for context, this was my first YCS after 7 years. Wow. I went to the 2016 and 2017 YCSs respectively. Both of them were streamed. Both of them, to this day, are still up on the Konami EU YouTube channel for the feature matches and the top cut matches.
They also had the token booth.
Booth that you could take pictures. They had a heap of vendors, I'm sure you remember too.
I was very, very, I don't have as good of memory as
they
you.
They had
but,
vendors that lined up all the entire side because they were buying collections. I got a Ghost Rare for $50. I was pretty chuffed, pretty happy. The entire line, there was food everywhere. This YCS, the organization was absolutely shocking.
It was worse than last year, and last year was after COVID, Telemint's format. This is way after COVID.
Right, that makes a huge difference.
Snake Eyes format.
The format made a huge difference.
Yeah, because everyone who was there was tryharding. There was no people there. They were fun. It was flu or Telemint or you're dumb.
Yeah, because Pepe format specifically was more important than, you know, Snake Eyes.
The only thing that made that event good was the people there were generally nicer than last time.
Mm.
This event sucked on every Konami front.
So yeah, as you can tell, we had a great time.
We had a great time, though. Because we had a holiday.
I don't know about you, but I had great fun up in the Legends Room.
Can you please tell us that story?
That was a new addition, was the Legends Room. Let us just... So, enough bullshitting aside, we're complaining about the YCS, but it's fine. Whatever. We do the best we can. I guess we're in Sydney. Let us start the tournament match. So, we are all ready. We're like, we're in for it, boys. Round one is on Neuron, which is the... Actually, thank you, Konami, for letting us get Neuron instead of lining up with the pillars. That's the one thing you did.
As much as it stressed me out, switching to technology, because I'm like an 82-year-old man.
Yeah. You classically have Alzheimer's.
What? Where am I?
The fuck is coming,
Genuinely, the Neuron side of things was fantastic, even if... Every single fucker that I dueled had their boss monster as their profile picture.
It was really easy to find out while your opponents were playing. You know, whatever. No streaming, food at quadruple the price, judges just breaking game rules. What are you going to do? At least there was Neuron, so we could actually see our opponents. Wow! And that's a Legends Room where we put the table 500 people at.
So, for context, they could only fit 384 tables on the main floor of the Cursed Stadium.
Yep.
They had to move the tables past that up to 495 up to a place called, appropriately called,
the Legends Room. Which is the Champions Room for... important. It's just another room.
It's the domain of the gods. I think you'll find.
Yes.
I disagree. I believe it's the Shadow Realm.
you went down there and you came back a champion.
Last YCS we hit capacity at, I think it was 850. This year they put it up to 1,100. It didn't sell out this time. In fact, there were less people this time, I think.
I think a lot of people.
There was more this year, but we had more space because they gave us a second room.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. 917 people beginning round one. So, round one starts. We all get our opponents. I look, I go, fuck, hooray. You know, last YCS was terrible, but we're just gonna go and have fun. I open up my neuron. I look at the list. I go, that's my list. I should be looking at the rankings. I look at the rankings. There's my opponent. I cannot pronounce that. What the fuck? Oh wait, that's Anna!
Yeah, so I look at mine and I go, that's a Mushroom Man picture.
I didn't realize it
was.
Surely
wasn't. This is not Mushroom Man. I sit down at my table and I see Mr. Mushroom Man walk over and go, ah, I'm facing you. And I go, oh my God.
Oopsies. We versed each other 7 hours ago.
Ronan excitedly from across the room, because we had like three tables between us. He's like, Matt, I'm playing Anna.
I think I walk up to Anna and I start to cackle like a jackal in the shadows. I'm like,
in the top of Anna.
All right, break it down. How did we go in that one?
Yeah. By the way, I thought it had our names for the thing, but it had your account names.
It had our account names,
so
yes.
Every time I sat down, my opponent was like, are you Squink? Are you Squink?
Yeah.
And I was like, what the fuck did you call me? Yes. Oh, sorry. Yes. I generally kept having to do that. I kept forgetting that my name on that was S-Q-U-I-N-K.
My name on Neuron is my gamer tag that I set when I was in high school. And I was always very proud of that name. And no one else ever echoed that sentiment. And then in like round five, my opponent gushed for a good 3 minutes about how cool of a name it is.
People get to call you this? Wow.
What was your name?
My name's Rebel Bird.
Oh, yeah.
So I sit across from my opponent. He's, bless his heart, he was such a cool dude. He's like, oh, you're Rebel Bird. Yo, that's such a sick name. What? I wish I was called Rebel Bird. People could call me Rebel Bird. And I was like, this event
finally
was worth it. The recognition I deserve.
Alright, game start. Let's go from Anna's point of view.
My point of view was, this is my first big event in 7 years. I have not played Branded physically ever, and I'm facing against a Branded mirror match. I brick both games.
Sure.
I draw cross out designator twice.
That's good, the mirror match.
In
you need a star.
two copies.
It's worth noting that I quite heavily coached both of these people, and like, you know, they have their own merits, they're very, very good, but I was over there as the parent being like, one of my children is gonna die today.
And it was the
and then it was me.
Don't put this bit in. And it was the child that was gonna die is a child you fuck. Anyway.
Brother, you have to edit it now.
I was gonna edit
it.
Because
you're
out.
Not posting that.
I was gonna edit it anyway. So how'd that go, Anna? Did you win or did you lose?
I lost.
Okay, cool.
Why are you gonna be like that, bro?
Wow. Cool.
Do you have a little penis or
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
I'm sure I do. It allows me to be a dick.
Can you tell the podcast in like explicit detail all the ways that I am better than you? Ronan says, rubbing his hands together with glee.
I will be honest, I was shitting myself because I was like, I hate the mirror match. And Anna is a good duelist. You know, one of us has to win, one of us has to lose. And I was just happy to verse someone who I liked for the first round.
Yeah.
Thank God all of my opponents were so nice. Most of my opponents, the entire 3 days, were nice. I just want to point that out there. Thank you to everyone who came, everyone who talked to me, everyone who I versed, every judge. During the entire event, I got 9 judge calls. That's for the main day. Sorry, 8 judge calls. So I had a judge call for the... I think we had a judge call, did we?
Yes, for, I believe, Quem.
Quem.
Yes.
Also because Ronan's stinky.
I'm so stinky, I shitty my panty. No. I had round 4 and 5 had 4 judge calls each. So that was thank you to all the judges and all my opponents for being so patient with me, as I had to tell them what Lost and Super Poly did. So yeah, you lost the first one, unfortunately, but how'd you go with your other matches?
So my other matches were Agents Runic.
Wow.
Which I won in time, because unfortunately the gentleman that I did play against in game three did his entire first round with 2 minutes.
Whoa.
And burnt himself for 2,500 damage.
I did witness this.
I stood completely silent. I was thinking to myself, this man is not going to finish his turn and try to kill me. He is going to burn himself to death. And though he did.
Can I just say, it was supremely entertaining. I was not saying a damn word. I did not want to get any kind of disqualification. But watching this man summon, let's be like, okay. Venus effect. Venus effect. Venus effect.
Opening effect, take 1,000.
Stares at his board for 3 seconds, under his breath. Fuck.
Fuck, I'm playing this deck? He just realized. I probably should have bought a good deck.
Yeah.
There you got to win. What was your...
My other matches were against Pearly. I had a pretty good experience with most of my opponents. Bar this Pearly player.
Oh no.
I did win against. However, the man decided to just shuffle his cards and start playing as if like I pretended like I did not know nothing. For context, I played Pearly before I started playing Branded. He started playing and I said to him, very kindly, I said, can you announce your moves? Because he was just playing silently.
So annoying.
He said to me, and I quote, it is your fault if you do not hear me when I am announcing my moves, because I do not have a loud voice. That would have been context for a judge call, and I probably should have, but I beat him anyways because I gimmick puppet locked him twice.
Karma. Karma and war crimes. Karma and war crimes.
As it turns out, I was his only loss of the day because he ended up on the top tables.
How does it feel knowing you're a permanent stain on his record for YTS Sydney?
Yes, and I will always be that stain for the little man who clearly did not have a conscience to talk to a woman.
Editor Ronan, can you put up that guy's full name and address and Konami ID? Thank you.
IP address, bank account details, mother's maiden name.
IP Masquerina SP Lil Knight. Go.
Very good.
My other rounds weren't too interesting. I did lose, I think, one or two. I lost one to Time, to, I believe it was just Runic. I lost to Labyrinth, but I did Jinzo him in the second game, so that did feel pretty good.
Very cool.
Spicy tech if ever I've seen one.
Yeah, very spicy.
I was thinking about it, but I was just like, I can't bring myself to do it.
It outs D-Barrier, bro.
It does.
So does Synchro Summoning.
And my last game was against, I believe it was Telemans.
Yes, it was.
So, yeah, I dropped after round 6 because at that point I was like, I have had no food. It has been 6 hours. The vendors are closed.
Thanks, Konami.
Thank you, Konami. I am dropping out and getting food.
To shed a small bit of light on that last game, I also did witness that. I've never seen two people having so much fun playing the worst decks I've ever seen in my life. They were so polite to each other and they were gassing each other up and they were like, whilst saying, oh, Medora effect, Shiren effect is diffuse, puppet effect, and I'm sitting here like, how are you having fun?
How are you having fun? This is awful and you missed it by a year.
The young gentleman unfortunately did not know what gimmick puppet meant, and after he moved on the field, started special summoning as he usually would. And then halfway through I went, wait, you had gimmick puppet on your field. It is your turn. You are still summoning. You cannot, sir.
No!
No!
This effect lingers, sir.
Wow. But, listen, you came to Gimmick Puppet and commit war crimes, and you did.
And I did, and I'm very happy and very chuffed of how I continued to play people. So that was my worst experience.
Very cool. Now, let's move on to the people who unfortunately stayed for no reason.
And did all 10 rounds.
Yes. We shouldn't have. Kieran. Now, you had an experience, didn't you?
Fuck, did I have an experience?
Go on, King.
So, look, round one saw me... My round one finished in a draw. It is what it is. But whilst it makes it harder to physically top, it also puts you in a really sort of, like, nice position moving forward in the day. Like, you're not versing the losers because you're a loser, but you're also not versing the winners. You're versing the middle of the pack, right? So I went in into the middle of the pack, and then it went downhill from there. I'm trying to think. That's right. I lost in a branded mirror match to arguably the worst built branded deck I think I've ever seen in my life.
I hate that.
Simply because I drew Tuma Korea, a trap, and two other just irrelevant cards that couldn't do anything.
Really?
Two
beast you drew irrelevant bricks in your list. That's crazy.
Crazy.
Please continue.
No, I think I think it was actually that's right. It was three DD Crow. Three DD Crow Mercuria trap.
Bro's playing Flame Mode.
And then for turn drew another Mercuria.
Bro's playing right? Edison, I think.
Yeah, yeah. So I drew unplayable in game three. And you know, it is what it is. I lost. I then quizzed this guy on his list because he made some very questionable plays. And he's like, oh yeah, I'm so terrified of Ash Blossom that I'm playing three branded in red, the field spell, and branded in white as optional searches off Alibur because I don't want to get ashed on branded fusion. And like, to the point where he's like, normal summon Alibur, I go, yeah, all good. And he adds branded in red, and I go, oh, he must just have everything. He then proceeds to just branded in red straight off the bat. I went, what? Where's your branded fusion? Where is your branded fusion? He goes, oh no, that loses to Ash.
Cool kids don't play it.
I go,
yeah, so
wait,
best.
Wait.
He's cooking.
My body is rejecting that comment.
He was playing two Quem, three Cartesia, three Deployment.
Did you happen to get the count? Like, how many was he on?
It was a 40 card list.
Oh, okay.
He was like I said, it was the most cooked branded list I think I've ever seen, but I lost to it. So,
yeah.
The following round from that was a Viking Snake Eye match where I drew a great hand that just simply lost to Ash Blossom. He had Ash Blossom both.
You should listen to the first guy.
Yeah, yeah. You're right. I should just add branded in red every time, even though I wasn't on the card.
He was like, every branded guy was like, Ash is in the main. It's, fuck, are we going to play cross out or are we going to play like some other thing that gets around it?
This goes, guy was no. What's every other fusion spell in the game?
We just ain't going to resolve it.
Branded fusion.
We're simply not on branded fusion. It locks me into fusion summons.
But we will play opening.
And deployment.
Yeah, bro.
Fuck, that could have been me.
So, because
it nearly
I had,
was you.
I had a really mediocre first couple of rounds. So, I drew round one, lost 2, 3, 4.
Oh.
Drew round one, lost round two, lost round three. So, that brings me to 4 and 5. By round four, I've been relegated to the Legends room upstairs. Right, and I'm going, all right, at this point in the game, there is going to be so much tism up in this room that I'm likely to catch it.
Everyone who's lost four rounds has dropped.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Anyone who's staying is
just like, they're there as a piss take. Right. And so next round, round four gets announced. I look at my thing. Oh, great. All right. I'm up in the Legends room. So if you're in the main room, it's like hustle bustle. Everyone's talking. Everyone's happy. On the escalator up to the Legends room, it's just like silent and everyone's got their heads down and they're just like, man, I'm really heading upstairs in
round
four.
Bless those boys going to war.
I'm upstairs. I'm fucked.
And then walking, like, it wasn't like the escalator went straight up into the next room. It was like there was a tunnel that you had to walk through. And it was just like,
tunnel.
All you can hear is just the like the little shuffling footsteps of retards walking along. Like, it's just, I'm just thinking, oh man, like, this is not going to be a long experience up here. I walk into the Legends room. Now, shout out to our boy Connor Kenway, who was a judge at the event.
Yeah.
This is his first time judging a YCS, and he is judging up in the Legends room.
That's why he was pissed the entire day.
Yeah, yeah. So I walk in round four, and he's at the door, and he looks at me, he goes, Kieran, what the fuck are you doing here? I said, don't ask, bro. It's been a long day already. We're just going to... It's not going to be a long time up here, all right? He goes, no, all right, all good. So, you know, I go and play round four. talking to a guy. He was a nice dude, but he cucked me in time. To cut a long story short, I left him ample time for him to actually have a turn in game three, and then for me to follow up and thrash him. He decided, no, I'm going to combo for a billion minutes and then wait for 10 seconds left in the battle phase and then just go, I'm going to punch you for 200 life and that'll do. Despite my, like, the game state being like, he was not breaking my board and I was thrashing him on the follow up, he just decided, no, I'm going to play just slow enough so that it's slow play, but just fast enough so that if you call a judge, I'm only going to get a PE minor.
And not enough to actually.
And even then, you probably can't prove it. anyways, doesn't matter. We weren't there to win. If you're in the Legends room at round four,
you've already lost.
Yeah. Well, no. I disagree. I've already won. I just got a different prize. I got autism.
An extra chromosome.
So round four, I lose, and at this point, I'm going, this is actually cooked.
Right? You're actually a table 500.
No, unfortunately, I only dropped three tables because I don't think there was a table 500.
How much lower can you go?
I think I ended up on, what was I? I was on 398. In round four, and I dropped to like 402.
For context, me and Anna started at, I think it was 89 or something.
Yeah.
I don't think me or Anna dropped below 200.
I started at table 3. And by round 5 was on 402.
Did you get whiplash from the descent?
Yeah.
Just curious.
Yeah. No, I got dizzy. So round 5 rolls around. At this point, I haven't even come downstairs. I'm like, there ain't no way enough people have dropped for me to get out of the Legends room for round 5. So I'm like, I'm gonna just chill up here and just, you know, do the whole, like, protagonist thing of stare out the window down at the stadium and think about my life choices.
I could be at home right now with my wife.
My children could love me, but they don't. Instead, I'm on 402.
I'm right next to this lovely girl who's dressed up as Ojama Yellow.
So, round 5 rolls around. I'm on table 402. I sit down. The Ojama girl sits down next to me. And, like, she went all out with her. With her cosplay. Shout out to the Ojama girl. She sits down and I look over and she rolls out a playmat that she has, like, crocheted herself.
Wow.
I thought, okay, interesting, but who am I to judge? That's fine. There's other judges in the room.
Oh, I see. Shout out Connor.
Shout out Connor. And all the other judges who broke the Konami policy.
Actually,
to be fair, Connor did not break policy.
Oh, he didn't, actually.
No. He was one of the few who didn't.
I probably should specify, he himself didn't, because I was expecting him. I was like, where the fuck is Connor? Because I know every other judge here, and they've all shown up, and he hasn't. I think he just went out for burgers.
Connor's a good bloke.
He forgot his wallet, so him and his friends missed their first flight.
That's right! Oh, they all had to pay $80 each to rebook the next flight.
Oh my god.
Anyways, so round 5 starts. I'm playing against Super Heavy Samurai Centurion, which I've had a lot of practice thrashing Centurion. In fact, on branded, I've never actually dropped a game against Centurion. It's just very free. Even with the whole Calamity Lock bullshit, it's just like, bro, I got bestials, I'll just set a wall and fuck you.
Easy
fuck
clap,
you, dude.
Easy clap.
So it's really, it's like, it was turn the brain off and just here's a free win for me. So I'm looking at what's going on around me. Because at this point in the day, all the tism is up in that top room. And
it's like helium
next
early
to me,
rises.
I watched this guy, I don't know what he was dressed as, but he was in like the Joker outfit.
Oh, it was the Mad Max Joker.
Was that it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he walks over to the girl who's playing Ojamas. He leans over the table. This is mid-round. Bear in mind, Connor's like 2 people away from me watching all this happening and just like turning a blind eye to this shit. He's just like, brother, I'm not getting paid. I'm not dealing with this shit.
Thanks, Konami.
This guy leans over mid-duel, says to the Ojama girl, goes, I feel like your deck needs some more hidden spice. And then whips out a salt shaker and proceeds to crack salt over her cards.
Literal salt.
Actual salt, like I say, a salt shaker that he pulled out of his pocket and just like a waiter was just cracking salt all over her cards.
It is almost too fantastical to believe.
Unfortunately, they did know each other.
They did know each other.
Regardless.
So this same guy, so I was talking to Connor post the main event and telling him how cooked that room was post round three. And he said the same thing. He said he saw this guy, and Connor's a flu player, like through and through, a very, very good flu player. He saw someone playing flu, and he said it was like, you just watch this dude misplay after misplay after misplay, versing this guy dressed up as the Joker. The guy dressed up as the Joker, his playmat was Glad Wrap. And he was playing Hungry Burger Turbo.
Oh my god.
And beating this flu player senselessly. Whilst also salting his own deck. This is YCS main event.
Jeez, at least
where people shark you on your card sleeves.
Yeah.
And up here in the Legends room, here we are cooking.
Yeah.
We
are fucking
literally cooking.
God. I didn't know Joker had that dog in him.
So anyways, round five is an easy clap for me. And from there, I then went undefeated for the rest of the event.
Very cool.
Because after I got out of the Legends room, I don't know if it was the autism that I had absorbed and just made me a better player, or it was just sheer willpower of...
fear of going back there.
It's probably the autism and the sheer fear.
I'm not fucking going back. So, I went undefeated for the rest of the event, even though, like, round 10, my opponent didn't show up.
Wow.
But, you know, we take the dubs where we can get the dubs.
Your opponent also didn't show up, Burnsy. Mine did! So, our table was probably one of the lesser ones. We weren't in the top tables. It was, like, table 60 or whatever. There's six matches. It's me and my opponent, empty, 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 the one other Gold Coast guy and his opponent. So we just happened to match up against each other.
Speaking of round 10.
Yeah.
Most people didn't get a notification that it was still playing.
No.
And they all thought it was cancelled.
So I asked about this, and they actually cancelled the event, like, whilst it wasn't running, so to speak.
Yeah.
That's why when we all checked our phones that night, went, oh, we've all been booted from the event.
They're not holding around
10. We obviously haven't qualified for day two, so we've been booted from the event.
Yeah.
It wasn't until Jesse walked up to me that morning and said, oh, you're here, bro. You're going to play round 10. And I went, no, I'm not. There is no round 10. He goes, bro, the pairings are up. And I check my pairings. I go, oh, sick. I've got 45 seconds to find my table and opponent.
Awesome.
Thank God I brought my deck with
me. He was kicking children, jumping over tables. It was a massacre.
We were all just like standing around watching our one friend who had a chance. And then we're like, oh, fuck, we've all got tables.
Yeah.
Doesn't let it matter to anyone but me, but like...
It's true. I rushed to get my deck out. And 10 minutes later, I signed the slip and said that I am a winner.
I'm fucking believable. Max. Benzi, do you want to go next?
Yeah, look. I'm actually quite proud of my run for this event. Was quite, you know... Really quickly, I feel like this is probably the best performance I've ever had on Branded. I pivoted to the Thrust version with Fusion Duplication. I played a good mix of Extenders and Engine. And my arc heading towards this event was very similar to the advice I gave in the last episode. It was very much, I'm just going to focus on my performance, going to focus on doing as best I could. Very ready to play against the best players in Australia. So round one was against a Dino player.
The best of the best.
I love Misk, man. Have you read that shit?
It's broken. Misk the 3, baby.
Admittedly, I was very in my own head, and I was like, I forgot what every Dino card does.
Oh.
And my opponent let slip, like, oh yeah, Misk is crazy. Shame it's only in the main phase. And I was like, it is only in the main phase. You're right. Thank you. But no,
needless to say, he was in the Legends room by round 3.
Yeah, like, I genuinely, I think a very similar story to everyone. Like, I had one opponent that I'm sure was probably like a better guy than how he represented himself. He admittedly was a very hostile player, very aggressive. I don't want to talk too much against him. Every other person I played was incredibly cool, was an incredibly good person to talk to, and I had no complaints. And I was playing Gimmick Puppet in my list as well, and I happened to win, I think legitimately, every single die roll at this event I won. Like, for the first time in my life. If not every single one, it was legitimately 9 out of 10 that I won. And I'm on Gimmick Puppet, so legitimately every single one of my games, I think I had 10, 20 minutes to spare at the end of my round.
Yeah.
Must have been nice.
Insane.
Must have been nice.
Look, I won't go too deep because it was one of my run was very much, I lost a couple of games early. My entire score at the end of the day was X3. I lost a game right near the end, but I was for a long time was X2 and then just on a huge win streak. So I won against Dinos. I puppet locked him. Queridus was huge. I just made everything zero. He could not deal with it. I did some very saucy plays with Super Poly to knock over his UCT right before battle phase. Very, very funny. Game 2, I was against a Pearly player who finished in top 20, I believe. He was a very, very good player. He was main decking Gravekeeper's Inscription and 3DD Crow.
Beast.
I am on a very graveyard reliant deck with my current list. I was like, beast. I'm very much not going to be able to do much here. And I can acknowledge that. That was probably the one round where I feel like I played it perfectly and there was very little I could do at that stage. Round 3, I played against a lovely gentleman from Japan. He had travelled from Japan to this event. He was on Fireking Snake Eye. I am not ashamed to admit I got rolled. I played quite well, I did some good things, but admittedly he executed every line perfectly. I think Zelantis and Raging Phoenix is such a ridiculous combo together, and is very much something I probably did not account for enough at this event, because I checked everything else. I banished both of his Flambeau's Dragons, I called by it his Promethean, and he could still just push over me with just his engine and OTK me, and it's like, you know,
wow.
It happens. So I'm sitting here having a bit of a personality crisis after round 3, being like, I put so much into this and I'm X2. I need to clutch, like, not for anything else other than myself. I know that I can do this, but it is going to be an uphill battle. And I played some of the best Yu-Gi-Oh! I've ever played. I played, admittedly, the ordering of it is slightly strange. I don't really quite recall. I played against 4 Snake Eye players on day 1, so after this, apologies. I think it was 5 in total. I played in my next 5 rounds, 4 of them were Fire King Snake Eye. Sorry, 2 of them were Fire King Snake Eye, and 2 of them was Pure. I really rate both of those decks. They're very, very good, and my opponents were quite good. It does not help that I pretty much every single game took game 1, because I just give them a funny little puppet, and nobody could really play around it. The one time that they had Droplet, I was able to play around it, which is very, very funny. Yeah, no complaints there. The list played really, really well. I don't want to go too deep into the chaos, but the one player I alluded to was round 8. We were all exhausted. I sit across this from this gentleman. I'm a very polite person, so I'm saying to him, "Hey, mate, how you going? Good to be near the end of the day," kind of thing. And he just sits down, doesn't say a word, just silently gets out his cards, looking at himself, and like, "Oh, okay, that's fine."
By chance, was this person dropped out, or?
This was a branded voiceless player. He was incredibly
brother ooh.
Brother ooh.
And I say again, I'm sure he is a nicer person than the situation dictates, because at this point it's round 8, we're both X2. We've played a very long event. Game 1, I effortlessly puppet lock him. And he's like, he's one of these people who, when you're resolving things, he's just going, Yep. Is that fine? Yep. You know, just
me
doing his thing.
Up the slightest inconvenience.
I'm resolving branded cards. I'm having fun. We go into game 2. He does not show a single card. I execute the puppet lock. He didn't draw the out. He's like, game 2. From the most detached individual ever to suddenly cutting my deck full of Starlight Rares and slamming the cards down with the force of a thousand suns onto my mat. I was worried about the table. this man immediately, within 30 seconds, not even, like 3 seconds, power shuffles his deck, picks it up, draws five, starts playing, slaps down a beaten up, super rare branded fusion and says almost too loud, "Fuck you."
What?
Because I was playing branded cards.
I don't remember. You have not told me this.
Look, I was...
Boom. Fuck
yes,
you.
Yes, it was It was the most aggressive moment I've experienced.
Jesus.
And I didn't have Ash because I don't play that card in my current version. And I was like, yeah, man, pop off. It was...
Fuck you.
This man, look, he was very Blood and Thunder. He was very, like... In his head, he's like the protagonist saving the world. In my head, I'm like, this guy needs to just take a break.
This guy needs a blowjob.
He has not breathed in 6 rounds. He's been holding it in because it's not efficient.
Been holding it in because Gimmick Puppet doesn't allow him to.
Yeah, look, admittedly, I was very tired. I did not play my best. He probably did deserve to win the round, but...
But he didn't.
The mentality... he beat me.
Oh, come on.
He beat me. And, like, admittedly, I was quite frazzled by how he was playing, and it was so close to the end of the day anyway. Yeah, so, you know, I did lose that one. I won my last one against Snake Eye, and then round 10 was the fun moment of sitting... It wasn't quite back-to-back with you, Kieran, but we were, like, down the way, like, bending over, like, you know, saying, "Hi, how you going?" Like, "Oh, tough round, you know?" Like, the judges walking past, like, "You guys need any help? You fine?" Like, yeah, got the free win. At that point, I felt very confident that I could pull out a win against anything. I felt very good with my list. I will say one more thing. My highlight of the entire event, other than just generally my technical play, was at a level I did not think I would reach at this event, and I have to pat myself on the back. I feel I did quite well.
Mm.
I had Lullaby of Obedience resolved against me by someone who knows I'm on branded, and it's a Snake Eye player, and he declares Ash Blossom. And he didn't even bother checking my deck because we were so close to the end of the round anyway. He just paid 2k life anyway. He was like, "Lullaby Ash," and I was like, "Do not have it, my friend."
No.
He laughed louder than I did, which I think was trying to cover up his feelings.
Fuck.
I did a little polite laugh. He was Joker. He was like, "Yep, that's it. That's my career gone."
It was Jesse Cotton.
Overall, a very good one.
I think we did.
Spread your deck and say.
I think all of us did very well. Just talking for people that aren't here, Brock dropped because he was playing lab. He bricked game one and game two, and he's like, "Fuck this." He ran back to the hotel, built Manadium, and decided to enter 6 Winamats in a row, and he won 4 of them.
He went nuts. He was insane.
He went to the finals for the other two, by the way.
I saw him between rounds. He constantly had a new mat over his shoulder.
He just had 4 mats.
I was scared. He paid for his entire trip and made profit.
He walked up and was like, "Sup, pussies?" And we're like, "Oh, you actually made profit from this." Keep in mind, his friend that also entered the event that we really don't know, all of us and other players from our group had all entered, and we all got top 150.
Yep.
I'm guaranteed that if he entered, he would have gotten top 32 with Vanadium.
Absolutely. Again, our locals is quite competitive, and I'm so proud of every single person. Of like, the people that were there were all quite great. Like I said, the experience was fantastic, but a bit of a pat on the back for all of the Gold Coast people, because we all did quite well, and we've got to be proud of that.
Everyone except for Kieran, five of us went X3. You technically went X3-1.
Not technically, I did, and that was my score.
You went X3-1.
In your
but like,
heart,
you
went X3-1. Yeah. In your
no
heart,
one
you
counts
X3,
the draw.
I'm proud of you.
Yeah, you went X3, come on. You committed a war crime against a pro player, and Brock actually came out positive with the event. By the way, he went to the casino, we'll talk about that later, won twice, and was like, "I just made $250.
And is now addicted to gambling.
He's now addicted.
He wanted to go to the casino, like, 3 different times, and we were like...
We were tired.
So, you know, the house wins all the time.
We were tired old people. We just wanted to eat lots of food and sleep.
So after day one, I'm not going to go through mine because I've already in the process of making a video. these are the listings. So we have pro players and players that either we are or we know. Christian Urena, who is a very popular pro player, came sixth, and I got a pick with him. Chris LeCuc, who unfortunately showed up to the event and I didn't beat the shit out of, even though I wanted to. He got, I don't know, who cares?
With your nice.
Who cares? Honey, who's very good, came 38th after Swish and came, I think, third in this event. Kamal Cook was there, he came second. Our friend Micah was the one Horace PK player that was in top 32. He was 42 after Swiss. And right below him is our girl Cynthia, who just didn't make it. It was really heart-wrenching.
She did so well.
We have Pro Yang, who was another pro player. We have after Swiss, Catherine Mai, who is a I actually talked to her for a bit. She's really good. She was the one woman you pointed out that had a choke run, actually.
Oh right, yes.
Yeah. Cool girl. One of the top 32 people had a brother who entered Edison, and I played him, and I was teaching him how, like, Black Wings work, because he's like, I really haven't versed this deck, and it was a shout out to him and his brother. They were cool. You came 103rd, and yes, right in front of you is our mutual friend Dion, and right behind you was Aethryn, who went undefeated for the first 6 rounds with Hero, and we're like, no!
I would actually like to point out, I think this is after round 9.
9, yes.
I actually overtook Dion right at the end.
Oh, did you?
Yes, I did, because he did not show up for round 10. It's cheap, and I did not play round 10. Won it.
But we take the dubs!
We take the wins where I can get it, and like, okay, I need to just say, I know this is like, you know, again, derailing it, Dion has been in many ways quite a mentor for me, and like going into the competitive scene, and he's also such a little shit with the way he talks. So I had that moment of, you know, walking past him in the lines for the Winamats, and he was like, oh, did you play round 10? I was like, yeah. Did you? And he was like, no. I was like, I know.
I know.
And he was like, oh yeah, good job. And I was like, and oh, that probably means you finished higher than me, eh? And I patted him on the back and said, huh. Yeah. Maybe next year. We'll delay.
Me and Jesse were at the bottom tables, and although no one else was next to us, he versed an opponent, and that's unlucky for him. I see a person come up, and like a roulette machine that I bet on red and black, it goes, the opponent goes ding, 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 right next to me. Are you Squink? On green. And I go, fuck sake. Round 10, just give me a break. I wanted to play Edison. And then game 1, he wins. I lost to Dyrell. Game 2, I shuffle my extra deck into my deck, and then I just go, fuck. Now you got a king. I don't care. It was just like, you got it.
Well done.
Kieran, you came 184.
Confirming, this is at the end of round 9.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Cool. Then we all got dinner. We ran it back the same place. This time I was there, and the place that we had, they had a symbol on it for a particular culinary school that I actually have a giant metal symbol on because my dad designed and made that symbol.
Oh, really?
So at the end of the day, I was feeling very happy about it. I was like, yeah, this is a good day.
That was a meal for champions, can I just say. The portion sizes were huge, the vibes were really good.
They were very lovely with the way that they split the bill as well, which I've never seen before.
Shout out Ribs and Rumps.
Yes, we were all being incredibly autistic with our little slips with our individual numbers on the table, swishing them around like we're summoning Penrith.
No more summon Alistair.
So that was day 1. Day 2, I play the Edison, I bubble out. You guys go to Taronga Zoo. How was that?
Kieran was in his element.
I was in my element. I still want to talk to the horticulturist.
I want to see a horticulturist around these bots.
He was talking like...
The plant's nearly dead.
Have we ever seen like food critics or like just critics in general, the way they talk? It's like, oh, you haven't even garnished your plate properly. What is this garbage? Except it's Kieran with...
Fucking raw! It's supposed to be. It's a plant.
But it's Kieran talking about like stray leaves and plants.
Like, it's brown. It'll be dead by next week.
Me in Detroit.
Wow. You as a policeman.
We did create a new cryptid though, at the at Taronga Zoo. Would you like to tell us all about
the
Guardian Cassowary?
Oh, the Guardian Cassowary. That's right. Yeah, so the Guardian Cassowary is, it's this creature. Like, cassowaries are a flightless bird.
Don't tell them that.
Until now.
Until our plane trip back from Sydney.
No.
This thing followed
us. Taronga Zoo.
No.
Circling overhead.
Yeah, and then it followed our plane back.
Yeah.
And it boarded it.
It's drilling its way in with its beak.
It still follows me now.
We look out the window.
For just the tiniest
That's not the
bit,
noise it makes.
For the tiniest bit of context, we the previous year went to which one was it? It was
aquarium.
We went to the Sea Life Aquarium and the zoo that was attached to it.
Sydney Zoo. So we had our first little exposure to the cassowaries, and if this video ever goes beyond Australia, cassowaries are bloody terrifying birds. They will kill you and laugh about it. Karen enjoys telling the story about a gentleman who tried to steal some eggs and ended up dead with his guts in his hands.
Disemboweled
by this cassowary.
He was dead on a train.
Good.
So
dead on a train.
He got the eggs, but
cassowary left them.
His eggs are his brain.
I'll get them back one way or another.
You want your guts intact or scrambled?
Yeah. So yeah, just the energy of, you know, seeing a cassowary again, being like, this fucker's gonna follow us home.
We found some monkey nuts, that was cool.
We saw monkeys, yeah. Actually, yeah, the chimpanzees. Jesus Christ, their balls are
crazy big. Monkey nuts!
Very healthy over in Toronto.
Monkey paw!
And,
monkey fist! The monkey nuts!
Kieran, can you tell us your opinion on the bird show?
Okay, so the bird show, for people who don't know...
Play the jingle for the bird show, for Kieran's bird show.
That's Old Spice.
It's Kieran's bird show.
For some context here, for our listeners at home, I work at a wildlife park. I won't say which one because...
Put it up on screen, Ronan.
Yeah.
In a Moscow bird sanctuary.
Yeah. I work as a horticulturist in a wildlife park, and I also work in wildlife as well. And one of our biggest... Our biggest show of the day is our bird show. We take a lot of pride in that. So, naturally, if I ever go to another zoo or animal park, I'm, like, super mega judgmental on, like, their bird shows. Now, Taronga Zoo, the backdrop was fantastic. I'll say that. They have us beat in that department every day of the week. I don't think there will be another zoo that can top that backdrop. The physical bird show itself was mediocre.
They only have chickens or something?
They had chickens. To be fair, they weren't fake chickens. No, they were red jungle fowl.
It was
made a little bit weird, but
like,
I'm fairly sure someone was in the stadium eating KFC.
Yeah. The chickens, like, and to be fair, we have chickens in our bird show as well, but they're there for 10 seconds. They run across the stage and they're gone again.
Cool.
They're not a major piece of the show.
They're there.
But they're there. They flew a couple of black cockatoos. I mean, we do that in our show as well. Our flybys are better than theirs, in my humble opinion.
Yeah.
They had a buzzard that broke an egg. Okay. The show itself was lacking wow factor, in my opinion. Now, Burnsy and Anna both thought the show was fantastic. Right.
Well, we have very little to go on, to be
correct.
Fair. We thought it was fantastic.
Because they're fucking normies. Yeah.
So, if they thought that show was fantastic, why don't you come see our show?
Wow.
Our show shits on that.
You're going to, like, tie us up in the night, throw us in the back of your ute and pull up.
No. When you guys do eventually come to the park, I will take you and I will personally sit you in the spot so that you get your head cut off by a wedge-tail eagle.
The way I want to die.
What a way to go.
Speaking about wedge-tails, both nights, because me and Kieran over here and Brock are in the same shoebox. So we go to bed at reasonable hours because we have real jobs. And Brock goes, I'm going to go gambling with the other guys. And I go, you don't want to do that. And he goes, I'm going to do it anyway. And I go, fine, you just turned 18, by the way. Sure.
Pop off.
He does it the first night, comes back with $75 extra. And I'm like, that's it. You got to cut it there because you will never win again. Next night, after we all hang out, we have fun, we decide not to do karaoke because we're all tired. I think that's the one thing we just couldn't do. He does again. He decides, fuck it, I will do it again, and comes back with another 150.
Which is so infuriating.
Which is so... And then, as we're leaving, on the Monday.
Yeah, on the
Monday. So, Sunday, we're all good, we're good. Monday, I thought we were leaving at 6 a.m. It's 6 p.m., but whatever, we just hang around. We do bowling, we have some fun. Burns is annoyed, which is always fun. We fuck around with Anna's car, we do some drifts and some burnouts, fuck the police. He goes, you know what would be really cool instead of bowling?
The casino.
And we go, no. We're going to Good Games. I'm buying some Warhammer and you can shut the fuck
okay,
up.
Okay, we still gambled. We bought a box of Age of Overlord.
Yes.
We got nothing.
Jack shit.
We may as well have gone to the casino.
Yeah.
mad ups as well though. The bowling game went hard.
The bowling game was fun.
None of us are good.
Rob, how do you feel about the casino? Okay. He didn't like it. So that's it. We finally make our way home. The plane ride back. It was fine. We were fine. We had fun. We're going back. I wanted to get home. You wanted to get home. They wanted to get home. We were all fine with it. So we get on. We're about halfway through. I think half of us are asleep. I'm about to drift off. And have you ever felt like you have just got on a roller coaster and you're like, oh, I'm going to pass out if I don't get off this thing? The amount of turbulence for one single nanosecond as we just got punched out of the sky.
We dropped a good 20 meters.
Oh, we dropped.
God. I reckon we did. Hey? Yeah.
We dropped 25 meters in half a second. And me and Brock woke up and I go, we need to get in the brace position. The woman driver's back. because Kieran's already scared, I look back at him, he stares at me, and I'm like, the cassowary.
the sound that they make when they're drilling the door open, when they're like removing the bolts, Kieran just leaned over and said, it's beak, it's drilling its way into the cockpit.
And because we already had a rough landing the first time, as we are going down, we're in the storm cloud and we're about to arrive, and I go, Brock, I'm like, Brock, you gotta be serious right now. I'm being serious. You might want to get in the brace position, put your phone away. And it's the easiest touchdown I've ever experienced. There wasn't a single bump in that touchdown. I was like, oh, never mind.
And we get out of the plane, and like the entire left side is scratched to hell. There's giant holes.
There's holes.
There's this cassowary crash, circling overhead.
The Crash Bandicoot airplane from Crash Bandicoot 2 is on the bonnet. I think that's what we hit. There's a turkey there, I think. It was dead. There was a dog. There was a blanket moving. I was like, what the fuck is that? But yeah, that was YSS Sydney. It was good. It was great.
Yeah.
Honestly, a great experience. Could not be proud of everyone.
Yeah. All right. I'm going to wrap this up a little bit with a final question to everybody here. Out of the whole, like, main event, what was your most favorite interaction?
Ooh. With a person or, like, in...
Oh, just, like, in the game. Like what happened in a game that you were just like, yeah, that's the highlight of the tournament for me.
When... During round 4 or 5, I had a Brandon mirror match against, I think 4, 5, and 6 of the rounds, I was X2. And a lot of people I versed were just, like, having fun, which was really nice. And then picked right back up into pro plays. But... I versed the mirror match. He wasn't playing. I think he was playing like the 3 structure deck, pretty standard kind of stuff. Not going in all out on like Nidia packages. He was like, I had him dead on board, and I knew he had 2 Bishiels, and I was trying to get him to use both of them. So I hit him. He goes, and before you do, I'll Magnemut here, and then I'm like, all right, fine. I'm going to Mirror Jade target, and he goes, I will blah blah blah. Back onto Mirror Jade, target something. He summons the 3rd Joyswarm, and I go, oh, Super Poly? And then we take a 6.5 minute game call, because it's a Super Poly versus Serenia versus Branded Lost in terms of chain.
Oh,
and
yeah.
My opponent doesn't realize that I've activated Super Poly after Serenia has hit the board, and that it doesn't matter anyway. So we get finished with that, and then it's all cleared up, and I'm like, cool. Swing for game, he's like, okay. And I'm like, you're dead. And he's like, oh, what? And I'm like, yeah, Garura does double damage. And he's like, oh, I would have died anyway. Just like, okay. Game two.
Yeah, very, very good.
Yeah.
Yes, look, my favorite. I actually did completely forget to give a shout out to one of the most based individuals I played. I did say that 4 out of 5 of my games were some form of Snake Eye. The fifth one is a deck that I would very much like to play. There's a gentleman playing Horus Eldritch. And he was very cool. He was a very, again, similar to the energy I was representing, a very polite man for someone who's main decking 3 skill drain. he was such a cool guy. He was very fun. It was a very, like, if any of you have seen Princess Bride when they're saying, you seem a decent fellow, I hate to kill you. You seem a decent fellow, I hate to die. We were just complimenting each other while, like, cucking each other over and over again. No, the funny moment was he had solemn judgmented me early in game 3. He was very low. He'd clearly forgotten that he had solemn judgment me because I made quite a mediocre board. Like, because I had sort of sensed he's not panicking. I started summoning monsters and I could sort of pick up... He has answers, but okay. He had, I think, Eldritch and like one set card. So I made Sanctifier, Mirror Jade, and I believe Guignol. And there was not enough for game on that board. So I say enter battle, and he's like, sure thing, buddy. I attack over his Eldritch. He says, fine. I attack into him directly for 25. He's like, that's fine. I attack him for 3k. He's like, that's fine. And I was like,
I win.
I win. And he was like, what? So, oh, no, I have Quaquero set. Sorry. And like,
nah, man.
And, no. I was... After all we'd been through, oh, no. I let him do it.
Don't do it.
I let him summon it. And then I flipped Super Poly.
Cool, man.
I am respecting you as an individual by letting you do it, but I'm asserting my dominance by killing you anyway.
By using it as fusion.
I'm telling you right now, you shouldn't have spoken up.
Yeah.
Do you have one, Anna?
I do. Well, it was like one that I did sort of mention earlier. The lab player. When I sided out game 2, I was very nonchalant and being like, yeah, it's all fine. I won game 1, mind you. And the terror in this man's eyes when I sent Jinzo using Grand Guignol, he was like,
wait.
So and then powerful. I proceeded to summon Jinzo, and I believe he did a judge call to ask if he could activate a set card, and I was like, no.
Did you read the card?
Did you read the card,
you
sir?
Fuck knuckle?
I have this card specifically for you, and probably Snake Eyes, if I ever faced it.
Yeah.
Do you have one?
Yeah, mine. So the whole idea of the branded Synchro deck was to catch people off guard with... one, synchro summoning in a fusion deck, and two, with a toot of the branded. I cannot tell you how many times people picked up that card and went, why doesn't branded play this all the time? But the one that sticks out for me, and it's the one interaction that I wanted to have for the whole tournament, was against a Trap Tricks player who activates Pot of Prosperity for 6, digs 6 and finds Dimensional Barrier. Picks it up and just has this smug look on his face like, I've drawn the out.
I've done it.
He sets up like the most like just silly board of just like Sarah.
Goofy board.
It's literally, it's Sarah D barrier pass.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, okay, this is cool. I have everything in my hand to, one, not only access my brand infusion stuff, but two, do funny synchro stuff that makes big unaffected monsters. I start off with a normal summon of like Cartesia or something. Summon a Bestial, and he's thinking, he's getting ready. He's like, yeah, I'm gonna shoot this. He's gonna declare Cartesia's effect, and I just pick the cards up. And he goes, are you using her effect? I said, no. Oh, and I watch him take his hand off the card and go, what? And then I summon Chaos Angel. And I go, effect target the set card.
Hello, motherfucker.
And he goes, alright, I guess I'll chain D barrier. Call synchro?
Synchro!
I went,
sure.
Okay.
Brain infusion?
No. What did I do? It was something as silly as like normal summon Albaz into his Sarah. he was like, you could just see the look on his face. It was just like, I had the out. Didn't use it.
Well.
What the hell?
We have just one more bit to go through. I'm going to be splitting these up into parts. I know everyone wants to go away, but we actually knew the person who won the Dragon Duels.
Kobe.
He was, man, I've never seen an 11-year-old hustle as much as he did. He was selling, he was buying in
he
the main.
He did not sleep.
He went nuts. Sleep.
His dad came down into the foyer multiple times to, like, take him to bed.
Get the fuck up
and
now,
and he was just
son.
Like, Dad, I need 5 more minutes
dad,
to find.
Dad, I need to find Fenrir.
I need to find 3 Fenrir.
We found another kid who, when we were in the Pullman or the Allman Hotel, as well practicing, and he was like, yeah, man, I'm gonna win. And then Kirby comes up to us the day later and goes, I beat the shit out of him.
Yeah, he stomped him 2-0 round 1
deserved
in the Dragon Ball.
As much as I like seeing younger players and everything, bro deserved it.
But now he's got a big head and now we have to stomp him. We're gonna try.
He's too dangerous.
So he
got majorly humbled on Sunday.
Really?
And Saturday at the regional as well.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.